Did you know you can get these kind of epic shots with the phone that you're probably watching me on right now? My name's Ricky, and I'm going to show you how to print and assemble this 360-degree camera mount, which will get you epic bullet time footage on a budget. And if you stick around, I'm going to give you 5 ideas for awesome shots you can get once you've got it all built. This channel exists to help you take on projects that you wouldn't otherwise have the confidence to. As with all my videos, I don't just want to show you how I build something, but I want to show you how you can build it too. That's why all the resources I provide are free. Just download them from the links below. If you like this video and want to see more projects that you can actually take on and complete yourself, then hit like and subscribe so you don't miss out. Okay, let's get into it. Grab the STLs down below and start printing. Now I started with PLA with about 80% infill, but the parts just weren't strong enough. The whole rig was a bit too flexible. You may have seen my ultimate filament dry box video. There's a few shots in there that I used this rig for. The rig was all in PLA at that point, but it didn't really last too well. So for this video, I reprinted everything in PETG. If you've never used PETG before, I recommend giving it a try. You have to go a little bit slower, but I get around this by putting a bigger nozzle on. I use a 0.6 nozzle instead of a 0.4 and slightly bigger layer height. But the layer adhesion you get with PETG is so much better. You can get away with so much more. Everything's a lot stronger. If you just fire all the STL straight into your slicer, the orientation that they're in should mean there's no supports needed. And 80% infill is good. If you want to make it really strong, go 100% infill, but it's not really necessary. Once you've downloaded all the files, you'll see that there's multiple files with different numbers next to them. And that's because your printer isn't going to print to exactly the same tolerances as mine. So I've provided STLs for a number of different rings that have different internal diameters. Print these out and try them on the tube that you're going to use. Make a note of the ring that fits nicely on your tube and then print out the files with this number next to it. That way everything should fit together nicely and you shouldn't have too much fine tuning to do once everything's printed. Once you've got all the parts printed out, you're going to need a tabletop. Cut out something flat to the dimensions shown in the drawing. Now make sure it's at least kind of 8mm or 5/16 of an inch thick. This will help you screw the 3D printed part to the back. Cut your tubes down to the length shown with either a hacksaw or a pipe cutter if you've got one. Make sure to clean up all the burrs on the end of the tube. I use 7/8 or 22mm copper plumbing pipe, which is pretty universal across the world, and I ended up using the 22.6mm ring. So I printed all the 22.6 files. Makes sense. The centre pivot on this rig uses an 1/8 bike headset. If you don't have an old bike that you can steal one from, then there's a link below where you can buy one. Pop the braces into the centre hub. Don't force them in if they're too tight and get a bit of sandpaper, and just take a little bit out of the inside of the centre hub until they fit in nicely. Insert the center spigot into the base plate. Again, if it doesn't fit, clean it up with a bit of sandpaper until it does. If it's too loose, wind a bit of tape around it until it's nice and snug, and then screw in from the bottom so these two are fixed together. Slide your horizontal tubes into the center hub. Then add the counterbalance plate and the two 90-degree elbows at the other end. You don't have to use 3D printed parts for these, you could just use plumbing elbows that are designed for this type of pipe. But not everybody knows how to make plumbing joints, so I've included the STLs if you want them. If you're enjoying any of my content, why not consider supporting the channel by clicking the Buy Me a Coffee link down in the description. Don't worry, you don't have to actually buy me anything, but if you just click follow, you'll get to see behind the scenes and see what I'm up to next. The supporters with a special mention this week are Alan and Edward. Both bought me multiple coffees, which was really kind, but more importantly, left me great messages, which I loved reading. Cheers, guys. Screw your base plate to something solid, and then screw your platform plate to the underside of your tabletop that you've already cut out. Now, obviously, make sure it's in the middle. Assemble all of the bearing parts as shown. And then fit your platform plate onto the top of the center spindle. Screw down through the middle into the center spindle and tighten everything until there's no play left in the arm, but you're not actually binding it up and stopping the movement. Now you can fit the two vertical tubes into the elbows and fit your camera plate onto the top. With everything now assembled, just gently check that everything rotates and everything's straight before then drilling and screwing everything together. Now fit some kind of phone mount to the camera plate. There are lots of different options for these and I've put one down in the description, but chances are you're going to have one of these about. If not, just pick something that works for you and screw it on. You can also fit some kind of action cam. You obviously want something that can do a high frame rate so that you can slow it down and it doesn't want to be too heavy. Now tape or cable tie some sort of counterweight onto the counterbalance plate. You need to do this to balance out the phone or camera at the other end, so it's going to be a different weight and a different position of this plate for everybody. Just experiment until you get something that's balanced. I find the best way to balance this is actually remove the top section again so you can see your center spindle and the top of the hub. Experiment with different weights or different positions of the counterbalance plate until everything sits nice and balanced. Then you're going to want to put your top section back on again. Now, if this is the last time that you're going to put everything together, put a little bit of grease or lubricant on your bearings. It doesn't really matter what you use, just have something that gives the bearings a little bit of lubrication so it's not metal on metal. Reassemble and just check that everything spins freely and that whatever counterbalance you've added doesn't foul on anything as it spins round. Now, at this stage, if everything's gone well, you should be ready to go. Now, the basics of what you're trying to do here is have the camera focused on an object whilst it's moving and you take a slow-mo video of some kind of action. That way, when you slow everything down, not only have you got a cool slow-mo of something happening, but the camera has got motion as well. If you're using your phone, you're probably going to want to trigger the shutter remotely. So get yourself one of these Bluetooth shutter remotes and then hit the button as soon as the action happens. This is where I get to the five ideas for things to film. Now, I have to admit, I know next to nothing about cameras, so all of this footage you're about to see is either straight out of my phone or my GoPro. Most of it's filmed at 240 frames per second and then slowed down to 25 frames per second. If you've got a phone or camera that does a higher frame rate than this that you can then slow down, you're going to get even better footage. You're going to want to film something that you can't normally see the detail of because it happens too fast. The first thing I'd start with is something that bounces, so you could use beads, bouncy balls, or even rice. You just want something that bounces back up, and the more the better. Another thing that can look good is steam or smoke. All I used was a household iron on the steam setting to make this little guy look like he's in the middle of a battle or an 80s pop video. Next, number three, once you've got the hang of the timing, you can start moving on to some of the more difficult ones. Try filming something breaking. You could use an egg, some Lego, just anything that's going to break and send little bits all over the place for a dramatic slow-mo. Now we've started making a mess, we might as well really get into it. Number four is using water or powder. Your imagination is your only limitation here. This rig can get wet and dirty, so go for it. You can drop stuff, splash stuff, just generally make a mess and film it. Now number five, and my personal favourite, is fire. Now it goes without saying that you need to be careful here, but filming something that's burning or on fire can look pretty cool in slow-mo. One of my favourite things to film is steel wool. It burns pretty slowly and doesn't get out of control, so it's perfect for lighting a dramatic scene in slow-mo. As an extra bonus tip, try reversing any of that footage for some weird effects. I'd love to see some footage that you guys come up with. If anybody actually builds this and takes some good footage, send it to me. If I get enough, I'll put them all together and put a video out on the channel. Drop a comment below if you've got any cool ideas on things that I've forgotten to mention. As always, I'd love to know if anybody's actually building any of these things. So drop a comment down below if you're building one or plan to build one. And also if you've got any ideas for something that I've missed. Don't forget to like and subscribe. If you like, it tells YouTube that you like this kind of video. And if you subscribe, it'll tell YouTube that you actually like my videos and it will show you more. I've got more easy to make projects in the pipeline and you won't want to miss out on those.